Want to make sure you get in line first, okay? So if you're a regular attender here at Faith, hold back, let the others go. Kind of like God holding back the waters of the Red Sea, okay? You are the Red Sea, and they are Israel getting to go first, okay? Then the other thing is, many of you probably don't know this, some of you do. Today was Sherry's last day of directing the choir, and last week was her last day of directing the bells. She needed to resign from those positions, and so I just wanted to say thank you to her for her years of service in doing that. And then for a number of years also, Nancy has shared time with Sarah playing the piano for us in first service, and today is her last day to do that also. So thank you, Nancy, for filling that gap. Now pray with me real quickly. Father God, we come to this time where it is about you and your word speaking to our hearts. So open us, Lord. Calm our thoughts. Help us to focus on what you have to say, for we are your servants and we are listening. Amen. So I read this week, and you've probably heard this too, I read this week about a professor who was standing before his class and his students, he picked up a jar, kind of like this, a jug, and he put a bunch of golf balls in it. And then he looked at them and he said, "Is this full?" And they said, "Well, yeah, it's got a bunch of golf balls in it." Well, then he took some smaller pebbles and he poured the smaller pebbles in, and they filled in all the cracks around the golf balls. And then he looked at them and he said, "Now is it full?" And they said, "Well, yeah, you filled in all the cracks between the golf balls. Of course it's full." So then he took a little bit of sand, and he poured sand in, and it filled all the cracks between all the little pebbles. And then he looked at them, and he said, "Now, is it full?" And they said, "Well, yeah, because he filled in all the cracks between the pebbles." I don't know if this class wasn't very bright, but they kept going along with it, okay? And so then, finally, he took some water, and he poured water into the container. And then he said, "Is it full?" Now, the reason I share that story with you is because of what it says here. First things first. You see, that only works if he puts the items in the container in the proper way, in the proper order, right? If he fills that jug full of water, then he's got no room to put anything else in. If he fills it full of sand, he can't get anything else in. So he's got to do it in the correct order. He's got to fill the container up in the right way. He's got to put first things first. The larger things need to go in first, then the not so small, or the not so large, and then the smaller, and then the smallest, and the liquid. Otherwise, he would not be able to get everything in the container. Now, this idea then of first things first applies to us in our discussion of change. Over the last several weeks, we have been talking about change. And if you want to get people excited, quote unquote, just talk about change. But when we think about change in the church, we think about how that change is going to affect me, right? What will I have to give up? What of the things that I like will not be the same anymore? What's going to change about the building, or the service, or the dress code, or the way we go about doing things? Or will one style of music push the other style of music out? Or will anything be as I want it? In actuality, you see, our greatest change, our greatest need for change, has nothing to do with a building, has nothing to do with a service, has nothing to do with what we wear, has nothing to do with the music, has nothing to do with any of that. The greatest change that we need to make, the greatest change we need to have made upon us, is the change our hearts. First things first mean we must change our hearts. Because if we don't, then it doesn't matter what else we do, it doesn't matter what other changes might be made down the line, they will not do what we desire them to do. They will not accomplish what God desires us to accomplish. And so it's got to start with our heart. If you have your Bible, or the Pew Bible, or if you have your phone or tablet, and you have a Bible app on there, open it to Psalm 51. We're going to read a few verses out of David's Psalm. We're going to start in verse 10 and read through verse 17. And then we're going to talk about the first few verses as we talk about this idea of starting with our heart. So Psalm 51, verse 10, David writes, "Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain it. Then I will teach transgressors your ways and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from blood guilt, O God, the God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. O God, you will not despise." This is one of four psalms of penance. Penance. The idea of understanding your remorse about your sin, of seeking forgiveness, of seeking to make what you have done wrong right in some way. So throughout the Psalms, there are four of these type of Psalms written for that very purpose. When someone has felt the weight of the sin upon them, they've come to God and they've shared one of these Psalms, and that has been a way of them cleansing their soul. Seeking forgiveness. This is what the Jews would do when they would embrace these psalms. And that is what David is doing in Psalm 51. Now, at the beginning of Psalm 51, you probably have a note that says that this psalm was written by David after he was confronted by Nathan because of his relationship with Bathsheba. So this psalm was written in direct response to a specific event in the life of David. An event that probably a lot of us have heard, maybe some of us haven't, or it's been a while since we've heard the story, so let me recap it for you. The story takes place in 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel is a historical book. It recounts the events, the history of the people of God, of Israel. It recounts David's reign and handing off of that reign to his son Solomon. So, in 2 Samuel chapter 12, one day David is up on his roof walking around. In those days, the roofs were flat. They were used as kind of like we would use a deck or a patio today. And so he is up walking around on the roof of his palace. And as he's doing that, he looks over to another roof and he sees a beautiful woman who is taking a bath, and her name is Bathsheba. David wants to know who she is, and so he sends a servant of his to her and has her brought to him. David sleeps with Bathsheba, even though she is married to Uriah, a soldier in the army that David is the commander of. As a result of that encounter, Bathsheba becomes pregnant. And to cover what he has done, to hide this awful deed, David calls for Uriah to come in from the battlefield to spend the night with his wife, so that if he does that, the child will be covered and everybody will think that it is Uriah's child, and it will cover up what David has done. But Uriah is too noble of a man. He is a man of high character and high integrity, and he says to the king, I cannot do that while my men are out in battle risking their lives. I will not do that. And so Uriah sleeps on the steps of his house. Doesn't even go into the home. He stays outside. So this foils David's plan A, and he must turn then to plan B. Plan B is that he has Uriah killed in the line of battle. Once he knows Uriah is dead, he takes Bathsheba for his wife. And one of the great understatements of the whole Bible, in 2 Samuel 12, we are told, David's actions displeased the Lord. Several months later, throughout this whole time, David refuses to acknowledge that he has done anything wrong. He fails to see that he has sinned against God. He fails to see that his actions have displeased God. Until one day, Nathan the prophet comes before him, tells him a story, and confronts him with his sin. David's eyes then are opened. He recognizes what he has done, and he is overcome with this regret and remorse for his sin, and he writes Psalm 51 as an expression of the guilt that now weighs upon him. He writes Psalm 51 as a way for God to come back into his life and restore him and forgive him and to cleanse him. And so in response, David writes verse 10, create in me a pure heart, O God. The word he uses for create is the same word that is used in Genesis 1 when it talks about God creating the sun and the stars and the moon and the land and the sea. All of those things, God spoke, it was created. It came out of nothing. So for David, it carries the idea of God doing something new in him. Of God changing his sin-filled heart and replacing it with one that is new, that is pure, that is clean, that is right with him. It reminds us of God's words to Ezekiel where he said, I will replace your heart of stone with a heart of flesh. I will give you a new heart. David is seeking change. A change for his heart, for God to change his heart so that the way he lives will be different. Now, I'm not suggesting that any one of us have committed a sin as grievous as the ones that David committed with Bathsheba and Uriah. I'm not even suggesting that we feel this great sense of remorse about change or that we view change in a way that is equal to what David felt and experienced. My point is simply this, that our attitude should be the same as David's. That every day we should want God to create in me a pure heart. That we should want God to change our heart. And to understand that we need to do that first if we are going to have any kind of impact on our community and on our culture that is far from God. It must start here. It must start in our heart. So what does it mean then for our heart to be changed? Well, throughout this series, I mentioned on several occasions that we, as the Church of Jesus Christ, we are called to connect with a culture that is far from God, right? Well, while some changes to our buildings, some changes to our services will be good and necessary, my contention, my belief is that those alone will not help us grow. That those alone will not help us fulfill our mission of gather, grow, and go. That those alone will not enable us to be the disciple makers that Jesus commanded us to be. No, those are byproducts of changed hearts. Those are byproducts of hearts that are broken for a world that is without Jesus. Those are byproducts of a heart that has a deep and sincere compassion for those who are not believers. Those are the hearts that hurt for people who are going to hell. Those are hearts that need to see people with the eyes of Christ and seek to connect with them on an individual and on a personal level. Those things won't have an impact until our hearts are changed to the point where every morning we get up and we cry out to God, use me to help them see you. In the Gospel of Matthew, Jesus had an interesting encounter. It's in Matthew 9, and he's putting together his 12 disciples, and he comes to Matthew, he's in a tax collector's booth, right? And tax collectors, you know, they were like the low man on the totem pole. They weren't the bottom of the barrel. They were like, you know, there was the bottom of the barrel and 50 feet of junk, and then the tax collectors kind of people, okay? I mean, they were not highly thought of. And Jesus walks by Matthew and says, Matthew, come follow me. And Matthew leaves his tax collector booth. He follows Jesus. And in response to that, he invites Jesus over to his house for dinner. He says, Jesus, I want you to come. I want you to meet my friends. On that day and age, the only friends the tax collector had were other tax collectors. And so you can imagine who was at Matthew's house. And in response to or seeing all of this, the Pharisees, they said, why does Jesus eat with these tax collectors and sinners? In one translation of the Bible, that story or their question is phrased this way. Why does Jesus eat with such scum? That was the view the Pharisees had. Sinners. And Jesus said to them, he said that they needed to see people the right way, and he asked them to respond to this. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. The Pharisees were focused on sacrifice, on the church, on doing things the right way, on doing things the way that they had grown up with, on doing things the way that were right in their eyes. They didn't care if any of these scum came to know Jesus. Their only concern was doing things the way that they had always done them. They didn't see people the way Jesus saw them. And I can't help but think in my own life, and in the life of the church in general, that sometimes we act way too much like Pharisees. Focus too much on the sacrifice and on the ritual and on the way things have always been done, and we so often miss mercy. We fail to take in the mercy that has been shown to us, to share that mercy with others. Before you think that I am preaching down to you or preaching to you at all, rest assured this is my heart, hardest and first and foremost. One of the beautiful things about David's song is that we can learn some things to do that will help us have a changed heart, that will help us to see people differently and then act accordingly. And the first thing I think we learn from David's song is that we need to refuse to focus on ourselves. You know, for many months, David was blind to what had gone on. Right? He got rid of Uriah. Bathsheba was his wife. She was pregnant. They were going on about life. He acted as if nothing had happened. I mean, he was the king, right? He saw a beautiful woman and he wanted her, so he took her. He was the commander of the army, so when this little discretion became a big problem, well, he just simply used his power to clean up the mess. His focus was entirely upon himself. And how often in the church we can become very much inward focused. I like church this way. The service should fit my wants. If they don't like it, then they should change. We have our groups and our ways of doing things. We are comfortable. As I shared a few weeks ago, the church is the only organization that exists for the benefit of those outside of it. We are not a country club. Membership does not entitle us to be served or to have our every want met. But the church really is a movement with its focus on helping people be transformed by the power of God. So if we want to grow, if we want to make a difference, if we want to have an impact, then we must allow our hearts to be changed so that we can connect with neighbors, classmates, and co-workers, so that we see that this is not about us. It is about God using us to help draw people closer to Him. Secondly, from David's song, we see that we need to receive a willing spirit. David asked that God would give him a steadfast spirit, a spirit of perseverance, a spirit to stay close to God, a spirit that would enable him to do what God wanted him to do, a spirit that would enable him to live as God desired him to live. If we are believers, we have the Holy Spirit living in us, guiding us, directing us, helping us to see what we should be doing. A heart changed, or a changed heart asks God for the ability to persevere and to trust that God will enable us to do what He's called us to do. So that our attitude should be that of the old Nike commercial. Just do it. Because we need not fear. We trust that He's called us and that His Spirit is within us and it will enable us to do what He's called us to do. God looks at us and He says, you know the commandment. You know how you're supposed to live. You know that you are saved so that you can be used of me to help save others. So do it. My spirit is sufficient, He said. My spirit within you is steadfast. David's words remind us to help us realize He is always with us. God is always with us. David cried out, God, don't throw me away. Right? Can you imagine saying that to God? God, don't throw me away. I know I screwed up, but don't leave me. He lived in the days before Jesus, right? He lived in the days before they fully understood what this was all about. He lived in the days before he understood that God will never leave us. And God will never forsake us. And as we think about changed hearts, as we think about needing to connect with our community and our culture, that should be comforting for two reasons. One, it means that we should always be on mission. Right? That every moment of every day is a blessed opportunity. That we should always be looking for ways to connect with people who are far from God, whether it be our friends, our family, our neighbors, our co-worker, the cashier at the store, whoever it is, those are mission opportunities. Because God is always with us. And two, it means that God will always give us what we need to say when we need to say it. It reminds us that this is not our work, it's God's. We do not save, God saves. We are simply instruments in the hands of the doctor. We are the violin in the hands of the maestro. We are the tools in the hands of the builder. God is always with us, leading us, guiding us, directing our words and steps into missional opportunities. And the last thing we learn from David is restore our joy. David asked God, return to me the joy of your salvation. He wants to feel the joy that he once had when he was in close communion with God. So my question for us is, what about us? Do we recognize and embrace and experience the joy of our salvation? And if we do, is it noticeable? Does it make a difference in your life? Does it make a difference in others' lives? If we are believers, then we should be some of the most joy-filled people on the planet. Think about this. If you are truly saved, then you understand what it is you've been saved from. You've been saved from your sin before a holy God. You've been saved from the judgment and the wrath of God. You've been saved from the reality of hell as your eternal destination. And so if you know all these things, and if you know they are real, and if you understand that through Jesus' death on the cross, you have been put in a right relationship with God, and that your sin has been forgiven, and you are no longer destined for hell, but destined for eternity with Him, how can you not be joy-filled? If you are not, then I suggest you question your salvation. How can you not be joy-filled knowing that as you go through each day, you have a great, mighty, awesome God who walks every step with you, who helps you navigate difficult times, who helps you make difficult decisions, who gives you counsel on what's right and what's wrong, who is your friend and wants to be with you? How can that not bring you joy? And once you recognize that you have this joy, once you recognize all that this is brought to you, all the blessings that this has given to you, how can we not want others to experience it as well? Are we so tied to our own wants and desires, to our own comforts, to our own ways of doing church and life, that we would rather have those things than for someone else to come to know the joy from Christ-filled life? And if that is what we're feeling, shame on us. Because that is not the life that Jesus gave to us. That is not the purpose that He set before us. That is not the reason that He called us unto Himself. So we need to have hearts changed in regard to how we as individuals and as a church share Jesus, share the gospel, build relationships with people who are far from God. And then listen in verse 13 to what David said. He said, God, if you do all this in my heart, if you change my heart in this way, then I will teach transgressors your ways and help sinners turn to you. David said, God, if you restore my joy, if you remind me of who you are, that you're always with us, if you do all these things to my heart, then I will be on mission for you. He wasn't changing his heart for his own good. He was asking that his heart be changed so that he could impact someone else. That's what God has done for him. Is that our prayer? Is that our desire? That our hearts would be changed so that we could impact someone else? I want to take just a moment and just have us pray for a moment. Spencer's going to come up and he's going to play a little bit as we pray. The altar is open, and for you to stay where you're at, to the front pew, whatever you feel comfortable with. But I just want us to take a moment and just to pray for this. To pray that God would change our hearts. To pray that we'd be open to God changing our hearts. To pray, you know, maybe you're at a point where you're like, you don't believe a thing I've said. You're upset that I'm even saying it. Okay, if that's where you are, then start there. But let's just pray that God will begin to do a work in us as individuals and then in us as His body, so that we would be open to change, not even if we don't like it, but we'd be open to it because we understand that God has called us to impact the culture, to connect with people who are far from Him. I'm going to pray long, just a minute or two, and then I will close for us, and we'll sing, and we'll end the service, but let's just pray together. Father God, I pray that you would change my heart. Lord, first and foremost, I ask that you do a work in me because I have failed you in this regard so often. And I admit it is a struggle for me, as I imagine it is for others. So, Lord, I pray that you would change me, change us, change our heart. First things first. Give us a joy over the salvation that we profess. Give us eyes to see people all around us the way that you see them. To love them as you love them. To express compassion as you did. To be willing to just pray for them, to listen to them, to have discussion, to serve them, to take advantage of opportunities to share our story. And Lord, I know, with this many people here, we're all at different spots. Lord, wherever we're at, help us to take a step, to do something. To see you at work in that one small thing. And then trust that you'll help us through to the next. To see this as maturing on our part. To growing. Lord, if we say we love you, help us to show that love to others. But the death of Jesus on the cross wasn't just for me, wasn't just for us in this room, it was for the world. You have chosen us as your vehicle to give your message to them. So change our heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I invite you to stand. And I just ask that maybe as a bit of a covenant, you can choose to say this or not. But I ask that you would say it, that we would say it together, a bit of a covenant. The verses that that David wrote, Psalm 51, 10 through 13, let's read them together, committing ourselves to a clean and pure heart. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew the steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain.